Hi, my name is Chris, and I serve as CTO at DAC.digital, and I'm here today to talk to you about blockchain. Now, before we proceed, a few remarks. This is a primer on blockchain, but more targeting the technical audience. So you'll hear a lot of technical terms here, but you should use this as a baseline if you want to dive deeper into the technologies revolving around blockchain. If you're new to blockchain overall, there are better sources, but if you want to understand the technical intricacies, this is the place for you. Without further ado, let's proceed. We should cover some basics before we delve into technical details. So first question that you might ask yourself, even if you're a technical person, what is blockchain? There are plenty of definitions, but the one that I like the most is it is simply a database. It's a tamper-resistant and immutable database, and it's structured in something called blocks, where information is placed in a block that is cryptographically linked to its predecessor. So if you create such a chain, you create a tamper-resistant record of information. Blockchains are guarded by consensus algorithms, and we're going to discuss those in a few minutes. Blockchain would make little sense if it was just hosted on one computer. Then you can simply use a database, obviously. Blockchain makes a ton of sense if you create a network of nodes that collaborate with each other, where each node can protect the security of the network, where each node can store information from the blockchain, and where each node is part of consensus algorithm that protects the network. Blockchain has some key characteristics that make it stand out among other technologies. First and foremost, it's decentralized, which means that there is no one single authority that can overrule the decisions that were created as part of the network protocol. It's also distributed, which means that ideally you do not host entire data set in one data center or on one node, but obviously on a network of nodes. It is also based on a consensus, which means that any information that is going to be committed to blockchain has to be agreed upon by the entire network, by the rules of the protocol. It's also tamper-proof, which means that once the information is stored, you cannot fiddle with it, you cannot change it. And obviously, by extension of that, it's also immutable. Technically, if you change something on the blockchain, the network would find that immediately because the hash of that block would change, and hence the entire chain going onwards would become invalid. And it's also transparent and trustless. And I particularly like the term trustless here, which means that parties that do not trust each other by definition can still collaborate using blockchain technologies because the transparent rules guiding the blockchain, consensus guiding the blockchain protocol, make it very easy to build relationships with parties that do not have mutual trust as core component of the relationships. Plenty of websites try to explain how blockchain works, but I particularly like this one, where we are delving into details that correspond to relevant blockchain technologies in a step-by-step manner. So let's do it together. First, before we even explain what blockchain is, it makes a ton of sense to explain what is a hash. Now, hash is, in its simplest form, a digital fingerprint of anything, of information, data, an image, a PDF document, entire encyclopedia. It's always obviously dependent on the type of the hashing algorithm. It's always of constant length, which means that regardless of the input I'm going to place, we will always yield the same length of the chain. So here's the letter A, and you can see I have a hash of that letter, its fingerprint. Take note of the last these are technically digits because it's hexadecimal. So take a note of the last four digits, DFFD. So if I type it yet again, it changes into the same hash, which means it's deterministic. For the same input, a hash is always going to yield the same output. And it's also unidirectional, which means that I can simply create a hash using input data, but with just the hash itself, I cannot recreate the input. Imagine I had this length of numbers here, of those hexadecimals. You cannot imply what was the source if you do not have the source. If you have the source, you can validate it very easy. Hey, that hash corresponds to that input. But if you don't have the source, you cannot come back to it. And to put some more context into this, imagine that the risk of blindly finding the right input is less than 10 to the power of around 78 or 80. It's a huge number. For reference, the amount of atoms in visible universe is around 10 to the power of 8, more or less. So risk of blindly finding something here is far less significant than finding the same sand grain on a beach or in a Sahara desert after you've flown back to Europe and try to find it back again. Okay, so that's hash. Now, what is a block? A block is a data container where you can place, again, any amount of data. In blockchain, it's typically in form of text, but imagine I'm putting here hello. And as you can see, any information I'm going to place in the data frame corresponds to a hash being changed. If I add an exclamation mark, it changes. Now, there is another concept in blockchain called mining, and mining is basically trying to solve a mathematical riddle as a way to safeguard the technology. We'll go into mining in details thereof in a second, but here, just for the sake of explaining how mining a block works, in this demonstration, mining means trying to find the nonce, which is a additional set of characters that will yield, together with the data component, a hash that has, in this demonstration, four leading zeros. So when we mine it, the process yields a nonce of 37,604, which concatenated with the data, hello blockchain, yields a hash where first, or in this case, even five leading digits are zeros. And that's how mining works in the proof of work. And again, we'll discuss it in a second. But what's the point of it? The point is to give the entire network a task to solve. And the first participant to do it will be rewarded. Now that's the block. This is block number one. And we have a hash calculated for the block as part of a mathematical riddle. And we can then maybe even understand how blockchain works fairly easy. Because blockchain, as the name implies, is simply a set of blocks connected together in a particular way. In blockchain, this connection is referred by a predecessor's hash as being part of the current block hash. So now we have here a simple demonstration with three chains. The first block as a predecessor has something called a genesis block. And here I can also write hello world. And you'll see I've calculated, or I've placed information in the block. And now I can mine it. And upon mining, you'll see I have four leading zeros. And the block is considered mined. Now, at this time, a point in time, it could still be technically manipulated. It's the risk is really low, but it still exists because there is no succeeding block still linking to it. And this lasts only a few seconds or a few minutes, depending on the network. But obviously, there is much more than just that that safeguards the blockchain. But this is just, you know, to illustrate the potential risks. So this is the block is considered mined, and now we are starting to mine the second block. So 1, 2, 3, oops. And as you can see, I have here two components, three in fact, the data one, where we store information, the nonce that's going to be calculated in a second, and also as a static component, the previous block's hash. So now when I mine and the block is considered mined, what happens is that information linking it to a previous block becomes part of that block in the blockchain. So changing something in the first one would already make this one invalid. And that goes on and on. For the same process happens here. You can see the previous block DPE links to this block number 2 DBE, and the hash is calculated with the nonce being changed to 100,557, And that goes on and on and on. So you can see the blockchain is simply a way of making sure that you cannot tamper with history, you cannot tamper with previous information, and hence creates a very long set of chained components that are easily searchable through certain APIs and through certain providers available on the net, but are constantly growing. So unlike a typical database where you can purge data, you can truncate data, remove it in the blockchain, you cannot remove history from the blockchain. It stays there forever. It's embedded in history and will not be removed under no circumstances, which is something to be considered when designing applications that are GDPR or privacy sensitive. But that's just a sidestep. Now let's come back to our main lecture. So blockchain is typically two types, much like we had the late 90s and early 2000s, the intranets and the internet. We have the same history in blockchain repeating itself. We have permissionless blockchains, also called public blockchains, that are what they should be. They are decentralized. There are no entry barriers. Anyone can participate and run their own node. Anyone can interact with the ledger. Anyone can submit transactions and mine cryptocurrency or be part of the crypto economics that is connected to blockchain. And then there are permission ones, also called private blockchains, sometimes referred to as consortium blockchains, where a large consortium typically looking into that technology, but hesitant to share it with the general public, creates an internal blockchain guided by different rules, with entry barriers, with permissions required to participate, and typically with no crypto economics. We'll talk about crypto economics in a second, why it's relevant. For now, just understand that crypto economics or using cryptocurrencies and tokens is relevant only in the public blockchains. There's another term that's very technical, but it's also crucial to understand, meaning blockchain, especially Ethereum-based blockchains, as a global state machine. Now, a state machine is a fancy word for computer, global computer. You get a set of inputs, and using those inputs, you move from one state to another state. Like imagine like a function that takes few arguments and changes the output of that function. Think of it in a larger, grander scale of global ecosystem, global network. Blockchain is a set of nodes that are connected to each other in a network, and each holds a copy of that ledger and stores a new copy of that state being changed. The challenge when designing blockchains is to create it in such a manner that those states are promptly synchronized across the entire network. So when one node receives information that a cryptocurrency should be sent from wallet A to wallet B, that information has to propagate promptly throughout the entire network. But there's much more than just cryptocurrencies. The blockchain, being a state machine, can also run programs, and we'll discuss that also further later in the lecture. Now, transacting with the blockchain requires wallets, which is a fancy way to just say it requires a private and public key. Public and private key cryptography is one of the core foundations of blockchain, but there's been a lot of efforts to make it easy to understand and easier to work with for people who are not at home with cryptography. In its most understandable form, a wallet address is the public part of the key that connects, that gives you a right to transact with whatever is part of a wallet or belongs to you on the blockchain. There is a common misconception that, you know, wallet is just either hardware component or a piece of paper that I have, and that's it. Well, it's not like that. It's just a way to help you understand how blockchain works. Wallet is just a key that unlocks the right to perform certain actions with things that are connected to that particular key on the blockchain. So you don't physically hold cryptocurrency on your ledger, on your piece of paper. No, that's not the case. What is the case is that on the blockchain, on the public blockchain, there is information that a certain amount of cryptocurrency or tokens is connected to a certain key, and that key has the right to work with it. Hence, it's always visible which keys have how many cryptocurrencies, which wallets have how many cryptocurrencies. These wallets can then transact or work with that cryptocurrency, basically by signing a new transaction and allowing that cryptocurrency to flow from key A or wallet A to wallet B. Since cryptography makes a lot of effort to safeguard information, and at the same time, we try to make it easy to understand for general audience or Web3 audience, the blockchain community has created a process called mnemonics, where from a set of, I believe, 2048 pre-selected words that are distinct from each other. So there's no like cat and cats. So from those 2048 words, we generate something called a mnemonic, which you can see here on the left. And that mnemonic then is used to recreate a master private key. And from that master private key, subsequent private keys and then wallet addresses are recreated, which again gives you the right to interact with whatever belongs to that private key on the blockchain. In EVM chains or Ethereum chains, on wallet address looks like that. It starts with 0x, and then there's a set of hexadecimals that identify the public part of the wallet, of the key. Now, like I said previously, we have coins and tokens as part of the blockchain component. And they are typical of public blockchains. Now, why is that? Imagine that in order to run a secure network, all those computers have to be connected to internet. So every node that runs a full blockchain node, full Ethereum node, has to be connected, which also means it consumes a certain amount of energy. Now, it will be very difficult to incentivize people, bar the true believers of blockchain, to run a computer constantly 24/7, pay for electricity, and be happy with that. So one way to do it is by incentivizing the people who run the network using crypto economics, using coins and tokens. Although this term is probably slowly fading away, initially coins were the cryptocurrencies native to a network, and tokens could have been built on top of existing network, but forget it for a second. What I want you to take away from this is if you want to incentivize people to be part of the blockchain, you should give them some sort of a reward for safeguarding the ecosystem, the entire network. And that's where crypto economics kicks in. Another term that's also important to understand before we go into concrete examples are zero knowledge proofs. They've been part of cryptography for a long time. I don't even know how long, but there's been a lot of working with them in the crypto graphics sphere. But they've come to gain traction and attention in the blockchain ecosystem in recent years, particularly as a way to mitigate exploding costs. So in order to understand how they work with blockchain, first we need to understand what are zero knowledge proofs. And that's very simple. So imagine you have a cave. You have two actors, two participants. You have Bob here on the left, and you have Alice in the cave. Now, Bob wants to see that Alice has a key that opens the door at the end of the cave. Alice would like to prove that she has the key, but she doesn't want to reveal that key to Bob, much like I don't want to reveal information to a bank, maybe, or to a government official, but I want him to be sure that I have that information. For example, I am full of age and I can participate in election, but I don't want to show my ID card. So Alice has the same dilemma. She doesn't want to show the key to Bob. Maybe Bob wants to run away with the key. Maybe she's just shy, but she'd like to prove to Bob that she has the key. So Bob and Alice come up with an experiment. okay, so if you do have the key, then I'll just step outside the cave. And so he does. And tells Alice, I would like you to come from corridor A. Now, he doesn't know where Alice went. Did she go through the B corridor and is here at that part of the door? Or maybe she went in here and she's just waiting here at that part of the corridor. So he comes in and says, hey, Alice, please come out through corridor A. And so she does. Now, at this time, he might presume she has the key, but he might also presume it was a 50-50% chance that she really had the key. So maybe it makes sense to repeat the experiment. Maybe she was just lucky and I'm about to lose an experiment. So they repeat that 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 thousand, a million times, which with each consecutive repeat, when Alice still does the same thing as she's supposed to. So they always challenge themselves with through which corridor you're supposed to exit. Bob can be almost certain, again, it's statistics, so there's no 100%, but he can be as good as certain that she does have the key. And that's how zero knowledge proofs work. It's a way of proving having something, having some information, having a key, without truly revealing the key or the information to the recipient, the person I'm talking to. Okay, so now let's talk about blockchain consensus. And as we move on right now in the discussion, this will become much more Ethereum or EVM specific. So as we've been discussing right now, something more general in general terms, as we move on in that presentation, you'll see much more information that is typical of EVM chains. And for a good reason, it's become a de facto standard for blockchain development. Like I said, there is one key characteristics of blockchain being that they are based on consensus. Like I said during early parts of that lecture, there is no central authority governing over blockchain. There is no admin, there is no super admin, there is no DBA that can change information arbitrarily. There is consensus. There's a network of equally important nodes or participants. But since there is no central authority, they have to agree on how things should happen on blockchain. And these rules are guided by the protocol rule set. But in its simplest form and its simplest explanation, they make sure that if we all follow those guidelines, the information that we put on the blockchain, we all agree upon. So there is no way of me saying I have, for example, 10,000 ethers if I don't, because the rules that are coded in the protocol, a rule set, including the network that is incentivized to safeguard those rules, will say and will call my bluff and say, well, you don't have those 10,000 ethers. And there are probably even more, but three core like basic components, basic consensus algorithms that are part of blockchain ecosystem. The first being proof of work, and it's typical of permissionless or public networks. And this is basically the demonstration I showcased you previously with hash, block, and blockchain, where the entire network, all nodes are incentivized to solve a certain riddle. And if that riddle is solved by first participant, very easy, the rest of the network can confirm that the solution is valid. And that person or that node will receive reward from the network as coded in the protocol for solving the riddle. This is typically a set amount of native currency, and then we move on to the next block. What's the problem with this technology? Well, as you can imagine, and doing a lot of computations, especially cryptographic computations, is very expensive in terms of costs. You need equipment, you need to run this equipment, you need to have it connected to the network, and you need it to draw power from the grid. And so as the technology became more popular among the audience globally, the energy costs for running POW networks like Bitcoin, for example, have gotten some negative publicity throughout the media. It's time consuming, it's energy consuming, it's oftentimes energy waste, because, well, the value of blockchain is not easily recognizable by everybody. So in order to mitigate it, there were a few evolutions of consensus, the most popular one being proof of stake, where instead of solving a riddle, doing the mathematical equations, miners or validators will give a set amount of their own currency as a way to hedge risk. They will put it in a contract, and from there on, they will be able to validate transactions, again, as guided by the protocol rule set. They will be randomly awarded the role of validator, and they will adhere to the rules and say that under certain conditions, the block you're trying to attach to the blockchain is valid. And if they try to cheat the system and work in their own advantage, the network can always challenge them, and they will lose a certain amount of their stake that was quote unquote hostage for them to behave properly. So there is a financial incentive. They will get rewarded when they validate correct blocks, then, and the network confirms that there was no cheating. And they'll be punished financially if they do something that does not adhere to the rules. This is much more energy efficient. You do not need heavy equipment to mine and to solve equations. So no GPUs, no strong voltage required to run machine or machines. All you need is just a server that has a node, full node synchronized. And then you can become validator if you are willing to bet 32 ETH in the example of Ether as your hostage. And then there's also POA, or proof of authority, which is typical of permission networks, where a validator is pre-selected from all network participants. You can have a set amount of validators. Ideally, no less than three. And then based on a certain associations or certain rules, they will be granted the role of validator every now and then. And they will perform the same action as validator and POS and proof of stake does. Who uses those? Typically, again, public, private consortia, like banks or like shipping companies. But we are seeing less and less significant adoption of private blockchains. So I see this more as a nuance, as something interesting, something worth noting, but not something relevant to the entire ecosystem of blockchain as we see it fit. Okay, so now that we've talked about consensus, you understand more or less the rules that guide attaching information to blockchain. Let's focus now on Ethereum and EVM chains, and then obviously smart contracts and decentralized applications. Ethereum was conceived by Vitalik Buterin. It's a Russian-Canadian that saw certain shortcomings of Bitcoin that he actually was enamored with. First and foremost, Bitcoin was limited simply to sending financial transactions, e-money or digital money. Vitalik had a grander vision for blockchain being it a global computer, which is a thing that's difficult to wrap your head around with. But bear with me for a second. It makes sense, a ton of sense. So he came up with his proposal for Ethereum around 2015. And him and a bunch of very talented programmers, including Gavin Hood, created Ethereum protocol. Now, Ethereum is public blockchain. It is enhanced with scripting functionalities and allows you to create decentralized applications. You've probably seen them, you've heard about them, you might have even touched them without knowing that you're working with a decentralized application. Much like I said that blockchain is a global state machine, Ethereum is this global computer we were talking about. And it's become a de facto foundation for decentralized internet or Web3 internet. Initially, it was very much focused on POW or proof of work with a fairly low amount of transactions. It was still conceivable. But as the network of participants grew, as the use cases around EVM or Ethereum grew as well, it became crucial to guarantee low costs and also allow the amount of throughput and the amount of transactions that was increasing with the adoption of blockchain. So, since EVM and writing smart contract codes on Ethereum became de facto standards, more similar networks also came to surfaced. Some of them basically copying the rules that guide Ethereum chain as a compatible chain, like BNB did. Some tried to do the same with building a second layer on top of Ethereum, much like Arbitrum or Optimism did with ZK rollups and optimistic rollups. And that's why I said it's so crucial to understand what zero knowledge is, because if you want to understand layer two and the rollups, zero knowledge rollups, you should also understand what zero knowledge is, obviously. So now we have a plethora of networks that are compatible to Ethereum that can run the same code, that might have different way to create consensus, that might have different way to store and bundle transactions, but on the surface they are compatible to EVM. And the root of their technology lies with Ethereum. So that's why Ethereum is so important to really understand blockchain as the technology we are discussing today. Now, why I'm repeating so much about decentralized applications and decentralization? Well, it's because Ethereum enabled us to move from Web 2 to Web 3. If you recall Web 2, it was that network that allowed us people also to create content, not just consume what's already on the web, but also to actively participate in creating and providing value, like submitting Instagram pictures, writing Facebook posts or blog posts. But it still relied heavily on centralized infrastructure. Web3 is trying to address the last part, to decentralized infrastructure. So blockchain, when we discuss blockchain in the context of web, we will oftentimes hear the term Web3. Web3 can be connected to using certain libraries that are part of JavaScript framework, one of them being Web3.js, the other one being Ether's JS. And it allows us to interact with blockchain as if it was just a storage layer or information hosting layer. As I said, there are cryptocurrencies involved in Ethereum ecosystem as well. The native currency of Ethereum is Ether, and it can be subdivided into 1 and 18 zeros away, and each further unit has then slightly different name, obviously, to correspond to the amount of basic units as part of it. Now, unlike Bitcoin, where there's a fixed and defined maximal amount of cryptocurrency that's going to be mined in Bitcoin, that's 21 million. Ethereum doesn't have that limitations, although it has slowly stabilized around 120 million currently. Why is it relevant? Because when there's demand increasing for a certain network, interacting with this network will call for this currency also to be part of your wallet, which also will create probably price increase pressure on the market, for since everybody wants to have that currency in your wallet. And that's why we see those demands, spikes and downs in cryptocurrency demand. It's basically to cover costs to interact with the blockchain with the network. And why do we need that? Well, for gas. Much like our computer burns electricity to run programs, to execute code, we also need to provide that energy, that electricity to blockchain. So when we want to transact with the blockchain, we want to change something on the blockchain, we need to supply it with electricity that is going to be it's called gas, that is going to be then awarded to the miners as the ones who are actively participating in running the network. You purchase gas with your Ether, and it's pretty transparent in terms of how it works. It's basically every operation that is executed on the EVM can be translated into basic opcode. It's just like in assembly language. You have some codes for subtraction, adding, logical ORs, ANDs, exclusive ORs, all that. And every operation that you perform can be translated into basic operation codes. Each of those codes has a gas price attached to it. For example, the most expensive operation you can get is S-store, or storing on the blockchain, so putting information on the blockchain. So if you want to save something on the blockchain, you have to submit a lot of gas as the price for the transaction. Much cheaper transactions are like adding, subtracting, or creating a memory variable. Why is it relevant? Well, because in the end, we want to create new products on blockchain, using blockchain. Those products are programmed, and when they need to be programmed, there's also a need for a programming language, which in case of EVM chains has two versions. The one that's more popular is called Solidity, and the one that's more Pythonic in design is called Viper. So using Solidity, using Viper, you can create any conceivable program that will be executed on the blockchain. Blockchain and Solidity are Turing complete languages, which means that anything that you can think about can be coded using Solidity and can be run on Ethereum blockchain. The things that you create and the things that you run are called decentralized applications, sometimes called simply dApps. And this can include things like exchanging cryptocurrencies using decentralized process. This can be creating art galleries. This can be having a game or even gambling or things like that. A dApp is somewhat different from a typical application that we know from our development process. When we have a very traditional application, like web application, think here Facebook, think Instagram, you have a consumer that can be browser, it can be a mobile application. Then you have server or backend that guarantees that user connecting from a certain session is authenticated, is authorized. That server also has static components like HTMLs, JavaScript, and CSS documents that are static in nature, so they don't hold any information. It serves those components to the browser or to mobile device, and using program executed based on those components, the user can interact again through backend and store information in a persistence layer, being a database. It can be MongoDB, it can be your SQL database. DApps are different. The only thing that in an ideal scenario is pulled from the server are static components. So anything that does not hold user-specific information, we have again HTMLs, JavaScripts, CSS, and that is then run again in the browser. But from the browser, you connect to the Ethereum network or to blockchain network. It's like receiving a token from your backend here that allows you to write directly on AWS S3. That's somewhat comparable. So when you have those assets loaded, when your application is started or the application, you will connect through a Web3 injector, wallet, can be MetaMask, can be today even Coinbase wallet, and a number of other wallets. And if you want to change something, you are the one who is making commits to the database, commits to the network, commits to the blockchain. So you sign a transaction locally in the comfort of your browser and then send it onwards to the Ethereum network. Here, in a typical application, you send the data, and it's the server, the backend, that makes sure that you are authorized to change the data, and then, based on that authorization, changes the state in the database. In a duplication or DApp, you are the one who basically says, hey, it's my data, so I can change it. I'm the one who's triggering a change, and no middleman, no server has anything to say about that. Like I said, two languages. Solidity is the one that's more popular. In the case of syntax, it somewhat resembles JavaScript, but it is still more adjusted to blockchain. It's a static language, so there, it's, you know, what JavaScript was supposed to be. Solidity has really implemented. There is the types are statically defined, looks like that. Now, in terms of information and calling or changing data, reading data and writing data, there are two types of transactions that are taking place as part of EVM. One are being called calls, and calls are simply read-only operations, which are typically free of charge. If you see a function that has a view modifier, this means that this function only reads data from the blockchain, and this will cost you nothing. Reading data from the chain is a free operation. If you have your own node, the only costs that you have are associated with running that node. If you connect to public nodes like Infura or like Alchemy, the cost will be probably defined by the amount of calls that you can make free of charge under up to a certain limit. And then there are transactions. And transactions are the state-changing operation. So if I transact with the blockchain, that means I am changing its state. I'm sending something, sending currency, sending new information, calling a smart contract on the blockchain. And I need to pay for that because, as I said, since it's a global database, global network of nodes, changing information on Ethereum requires me to pay for that. It's also asynchronous. While calls are synchronous, which means when I call a view function, I will get the result immediately. In the transactions, that has to be mined, that has to go through the entire blockchain interaction process with being packed into a block, first into the mempool, then from the mempool into a transaction, and then into a block. It also means that when I create a transaction, I will not get immediately confirmation that this transaction was successfully executed. Now, in terms of how do I write blockchain codes? Well, there are a number of frameworks. The best way to start is to use Remix IDE. It's a web application available under this address. And it allows us to simulate running a local blockchain using the browser environment. It allows us to connect to testnets, which I'll cover in a second. And it allows us also to connect with the mainnet using injectors like MetaMask. Remix is great for your first initial touch with blockchain. Gives you all the bells and whistles that you require in order to write and deploy code into Ethereum or EVM compatible network. Now, as your skills progress, you'll be wanting to write code also locally, and there are a number of established suites. The older one is called Truffle Suite, and has three core components. Truffle is, well, basically the framework to build smart contracts. Ganache is a local testnet, devnet, difficult to name, and Drizzle with their front-end libraries that make building the applications easier. It grew over time with all the historical technical debt that still remained. So a way to mitigate it was to build something new. And that's where Hardhat came to scene, which has gained a lot of attention and traction over the past years and has become probably a tool of choice to develop smart contracts for most of Web3 developers nowadays. There's also framework called Open Zeppelin, which gives us ready-made libraries that you can use in your Web3 adventure. Certain contracts, certain standards, like a token contract, ERC-20, NFT contract, ERC-721, can be already imported from Open Zeppelin and fairly easy deployed as your own new cryptocurrency or your own NFT token. What's the benefit? Well, Open Zeppelin contracts are audited. If you see Solidity code written using Open Zeppelin libraries, you can be fairly certain that it's of good quality. It's already audited, and then someone has really changed a lot of features or functions available from Open Zeppelin in their own code. It's a good building block to start your adventure with. Now, if you want to really run your own node locally, then there are some options available. You can do it really using the native, the official Ethereum client. It was provided by ETH Foundation and it's written in Go. It's called Geth. Then there's one that used to be called Parity, written by Gavin Wood, and it was written in Rust. But since Gavin Wood has switched his focus on Polkadot, the community has taken over Parity and released it as Open Ethereum. So you have two established ways of running local nodes. There's also Java-based Hyperledger Besu that you can also use, and probably a good amount of others as well. But these two are your good choice if you want to run your own node. Now, bear in mind, today to run your own node, you need very expensive equipment with SSD and a lot of SSD space because the blockchain is growing. So you might want to skip that part and utilize hosted nodes. And the two ones I can recommend if you really want to start your adventure with blockchain would be Infura and Alchemy. Alchemy, in my opinion, being fairly better than Infura with a good amount of products and libraries also made available by them to the developers. Now, when you build code, you do not want to deploy it on the mainnet, so the mainnet network from day one. An old proverb I used to hear over and over was, who releases to production directly is the courageous one, which is obviously stupid. You should never test in production. You should always test in a very safe environment. And for that reason, we have something called testnets that try to emulate how a network behaves. It's also run in a decentralized manner. It can be also deployed locally if you want to have a private testnet. And using those testnets, you can test the behavior of your smart contract and your application in a safe environment that will cost you nothing. Like I said, one of the most expensive operations when it comes to blockchain, when it comes to EVM, is to store information on the network, on the blockchain. Why? Because imagine all of us wanted to save our movies or images on the blockchain, and blockchain is hosted in the same size on all full nodes. That would mean that the amount of space required would grow exponentially. So we are punished for storing too much data on the blockchain. So what is a good practice? Well, a good practice is to use decentralized storage systems like IPFS, which stands for Intraplanetary File System, I kid you not. And images or assets stored there can be linked through their hash, because IPFS addresses data using hash of that data, and then stored as this hash link on the blockchain. So as a good example, imagine I have a wedding recording that I want to share with my family, and since I'm hip, I want to share it using blockchain for whatever reason that is. So I would put this wedding video on IPFS. Probably I would use a service like Pinata to also pin that information to IPFS, because if that information is not distributed across all the nodes, it will vanish when the node that hosts it goes offline. And then the hash of that wedding video would be part of a contract that I can read. And then upon reading, I can get that image or that video. I can get it found. Then there's also the topic of forks. Forks happen when blockchain diverges into two potential paths forward. It can relate to network's transaction history. It can be a new rule that is being decided, upon which we are deciding which transaction is valid. It can be users showing their support for one or the other way of blockchain moving forward, which we've seen in the case of Ethereum and Ethereum Classic. And we have two types of forks. A hard fork is caused by a software upgrade that introduces a new rule into the network, makes it also incompatible with the older software. Meaning that if you want to run network using that particular version or that particular node, you would have to update your infrastructure. And the soft forks are the ones that are still backward compatible. They might change some logic, but not to a huge extent. Now, another important topic. I told you that you cannot, I said that anything that changes the state of blockchain has to be put there as a transaction. Blockchain programs, smart contracts don't have the way to see outside of blockchain. So what is an Oracle? Oracle is a trusted provider of data that is external to blockchain. It can answer a question that is external to the network, but crucial to the network's execution. And why are they needed? Well, some programs are requiring outside information. For example, in logistics, you might have a smart contract that says if the temperature of your goods being transported exceeded a certain amount of degrees, you would want that contract to be voided and you don't want to pay for that transport because maybe the shipment of oranges has gone rotten. Now, that information has to be provided to the smart contract by a trusted source, by someone who can vouch with their reputation for that information. And that's where oracles come in. Oracles provide data upon request from the blockchain. Smart contract can request information saying, hey, quote unquote, I need temperature readout from truck ABC. And that information can be then conveyed through an oracle that will wrap this as a transaction and send information back to the blockchain as a transaction so that A, we have origin of that information and then the payload that is crucial to contract execution. Again, it all boils down to the fact that consensus rules and the execution of the EVM must be deterministic. It must be based only on the shared context of the information that was provided to all participants, not just one reaching out and saying, I need that information. As a closing process of our today's lecture, we have a very simple contract here on Remix. That's the tool I told you about. It's basically just a small owner contract. That's the one I wanted to show you, the storage contract, where I have just a small variable and I can hold a number in that variable. And I have two functions. One is just a retrieve function, which is a view function reading data from that variable. And the other one is a storage function that puts that information into the contract. Now, first we can compile it, and you'll see that Solidity has compiled this as a valid code. And then I could deploy it. I already have done this, but let me do it once again. And I will deploy it using MetaMask, and I should have it connected. I do. It's on a testnet. And then allow me to deploy. I will confirm the transaction. Now we need to wait for it to get mined. It can take up to 15 seconds, depending on the network. When it gets mined, you will see that there is a contract deployed here. So bear with me for the next few minutes or seconds. Now you can see it's already deployed and there's a contract address. Just like your wallet, contract has its own address. It starts with 0x. And I can interact with this contract based on the methods exposed to the outside or functions exposed to the outside. First one, let's store something. Well, let's retrieve something first. Nothing. It's no data there. So let's write information 1, 2, 3. As you'll see, writing information will call for a transaction to happen. So again, I need to sign that transaction and then wait for this transaction to be mined by the network, which means to be confirmed by the network. It's still in pending state. And now it's mined. And if I retrieve the data, you'll see that I have retrieved the 1.2.3 version. Now, what happens if I try to retrieve data before it was mined? You can see this right now, 999, store, again, sign the transaction. And now until it's mined, it's still going to be 1.23. Eventually, when the transaction gets mined, so in a window of around 15 seconds in this particular network, you'll see that this value here will have changed to the one I have mined. So now it's 999. Okay. Thanks so much for participating in this lecture today. I hope you have had fun with those initial demonstrations and initial steps into the blockchain technical 101. If you have any questions, if you would like to dive deeper, don't hesitate to reach out to me or to DAC Digital. We're happy to help. We are the experts in blockchain, and we're there for you. Thanks so much.